everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and we thought you might like to see our Frosty garden. Yes, we've had our first hard frost. We skipped out on it a couple of weeks ago, but it got us the other night. And when you're in the northern climate, you go through a long summer, then suddenly, just like that, overnight, comes a killing, well, it's not the killing frost, it's just the first hard frost. And then there's a time in between that first frost that the weather is nice again. It's up in the 50s and 60s, it's sunny. It's traditionally called Indian summer. But then you get the killing frost, which pretty much takes everything out. Well, this is what happens to tropical plants during the first hard frost. This was my elephant ear. Poor little thing, I just hate to see this. I mean, it's very soft now, like paper. Now, this is the time when I will be digging out the bulb that is underneath there. And it's got at least two or three baby ones off to the side. They will have to sit and cure for, oh, if I could do it for a week or two, that would be great. Just to let them harden off and change from growing lovely and happy to time to go to sleep.
Dormant.
Yes. So one of the first things you'll see, one of the first plants you'll see that gets ruined are the tropical plants, the annual plants that they don't like this weather. Now right next to this is a native plant. This is prairie dock. You see this one doesn't even care that there was a frost. It's still green, it's still supple. The stalk is still on, the birds have been enjoying it. If you look right next to it, you've got
hosta.
Hosta, thank you. And coral bells, they're still all fine, all of them. Brunera, that's fine. But those are perennials. They're used to making it through the winter. They won't look like this. When we get our killing frost, they too will be flopped down, and you just let them go until next spring and they will pop back up again, hopefully, if you're lucky.
And for those waiting for our house to finally be sited, we've been told.
We've been told, and this is, I think, very ironic, Halloween.
Yeah.
Halloween is when they're going to start.
And we thought, for Tim's sake, we would do the house black and orange.
Another one of the poor, sad-looking little plants is the caladium. These were the ones that had such beautiful flower leaves. And sometimes it's important to put a stake down where you know you've planted them, because suddenly, if you had forgotten where they were, you wouldn't know. But then right next to it, one of Rick's favorites, tickweed. This has seeded itself here. Doesn't come up from roots, but it'll come up from the seeds. So it's happy. It has not yet been killed. The sedum, you can see, is fine. This was my beautiful red coleus. That also, very tender. Goodbye. Till next year.
Well, you said you even had ice on the bird bath
the
other morning.
Yes, there was ice. Yep. Yeah. Now this is butterfly weed. This too, hardy perennial. These are the seed pods. Coral bells, like I said before. That is a peony bush. That's going to be a red one.
Tree peony?
A tree peony, right. And then, no. That's just a peony.
Oh, okay.
And then next to it is the hybrid that's between a tree peony and a regular herbaceous peony. Mm. That one's going to be yellow. Mm. And then there's weeds. They
well,
don't
even
seem
they've
to care.
Been at home, but look, they've been affected
yeah,
by the
leaves
frost.
Have been.
Well, good.
As far as the iris go, they too are hardy perennials. And you see the frost has not even dampened their growth. Once we have the killing frost and they are drooping over and definitely dormant, that's when I will take all the leaves off of here. I'll cut them down to the rhizome and just clean everything out of there in hopes that we'll keep our iris borer under control this year. Some of the fruit plants have been touched and some haven't. And on the grapes, you can see some of them definitely have and others not so much. The blueberries, they didn't seem to care. They're pretty, they're turning their red color that's so pretty in the fall. And here's that pin oak that we have. For years, tried to grow a pin oak here. It was a tree when we planted it. It didn't make it because, well, neither did its three partners, because we just don't have enough acid in our soil for a pin oak. We have cut this down numerous times, and it likes to come back and be a bush.
Well, it's healthier now than it's ever been.
Yes, this one would love to grow into a tree.
Yeah, well, you know what to do.
But it's sitting right here next to this pine that we planted because this one didn't make it. So we planted a pine. Now,
remember dragging this thing over? I mean, that's when it was a baby. It probably wasn't any more than 4 or 5 foot tall. And now it's got to be close to 20.
Mm-hmm. Oh, at least.
And then look at that. An escapee.
Escapee. Yep. Yes, indeed. One of you guys got carried away.
Well, this would be a good time for trimming later.
No, we can't trim them till late
winter.
Winter.
Yeah.
Because if you trim them now, there are still insects and bacteria and things, fungus, that would attack them. So they have to wait until early in the spring or late winter. Rhubarb has slightly been touched. Now, these were our newer plants that we planted actually last fall. Mm-hmm. And they did miraculously well. We even got a chance to pick some of them because they were doing so well. Next year they'll be even bigger. But if you look over here to the blackberry patch, they don't even care that there was a frost. That's amazing.
At the rate they're going, they'll be growing in midwinter and maybe fruiting.
Ooh, that'd be nice. Mm. And then there are the zinnias. Remember about a week ago, these were all in bloom. Well, they were still blooming up until 2 days ago. And the butterflies were having a great time in here. Nope. One night, that's all it took.
It is amazing how quickly everything just flops over.
Not the Montauk daisies, though.
No, look at
behind
those.
Behind them.
Yeah.
There again, they are a tough perennial. And they are one of the last flowers to bloom in the fall. That's why they're so loved.
Mm. Thank you.
And remember our squash with the spaghetti squash taking over. This is what's left. And there were even a couple of blossoms and there were little ones that had started to grow. Because you never know. There's a little baby one right here. The spaghetti squash.
What are you going to do with those? Anything?
Nope. Probably just put them in the compost.
And there's another one over there too, a little larger.
Mm-hmm. But they've been frozen. I suppose you could use them immediately. They wouldn't store at all, but you could use them immediately. The peppers, again, very tender, as are tomatoes. You can see that even the marigolds have been touched. The flowers giving us their last burst of beauty, but the peppers, no.
Yeah, look at how the peppers have kind of just
shriveled
and right.
Now we could have covered these because, like I said, there's usually a time between the first frost and then the killing frost, but they've given us enough.
Yeah, they were very prolific this year.
And we're very appreciative of them. Now we could still pick these red ones. They have not, of course, they're hot peppers, so they are not being touched by the frost yet. And of course, the tomatoes. They were on their last legs. You know, I was leaving a few on just in hopes that if we had a really, really late fall, that they would still have a chance to
ripen, but we knew it was about time.
Could paint them, spray paint them.
And the Liberty Garden, while it's higher, and usually if things are up higher, they don't freeze as much or as quickly. Beans being very tender, done. Zinnias, done. And next to them, you can see some of our perennials that we have here in our test beds. Still hanging in there. And then there's the asparagus. Tough. Tough, tough, tough. That will be chopping down to the roots just to keep the asparagus beetle from getting too comfortable over there. And this is how the giant fleece plant looks after the frost. You can see some of the lower branches still green. Definitely spreading out.
You can also see the damage that, because this is so dense, what it does to the arborvitaes behind them. Yeah, it just blocks the sunlight.
They
probably
don't
not
this.
The best place for this fleece plant, but
no.
There's plenty of other greenery nearby to keep us focused.
Our little pond, look at how lovely the
water lily.
The water lily is, and I just heard a frog jump in there.
Yeah.
I have stopped feeding the fish because if the water gets to be 55, the food you feed them won't be digested, so the fish too are kind of getting dormant.
Oh, I'm being attacked by mosquitoes.
Our dahlias are done. Thank goodness we got to see all of them. They were beautiful. We had, I think, 5 of them. So, very lovely. But they, too, now will have to be dug up because these are tender bulbs or plants, and the roots will not last through this winter. So if I want any chance of getting them to grow again, I'm going to have to dig them out, let them cure again, a couple of weeks in the dryness.
Somebody will ask, well, what do you mean by curing?
Well, that means that they have to sit out in a dry place. Well, not out. They have to be in a dry, cool place where the plant can go from growing to sleep. So they know that there's a difference. Once they're done, give them like a 2-week period, then I can trim off the majority of the vegetation and the majority of the little root hairs that are on them. And then we'll put them in open trays, possibly on some peat moss down in the basement. Another task that'll have to be done before we have our hard killing frost is we're going to be draining the top part of the waterfall. Rick built in a drain in the bottom so that this can be drained so that the freezing water won't push the sides away. The main one we always leave, and that one never seems to have been bothered by the freezing and the thawing, and that sometimes almost always freezes down to the bottom. For the lowest tier, we are going to drain also, maybe down half. I don't know that we have to take it all the way down, but halfway. And snow will come in here, you know, it'll be filled with snow eventually also, so it's just what we do.
So we'll go ice skating here in winter?
Out there?
Yeah.
This was my climbing spinach. It was so good on sandwiches, or just to come over and take a couple of leaves and eat them. This is an annual. Sometimes the seeds are finished and I can actually harvest them and grow them, but this year this didn't take off as it usually does until very late. So the flowers, while they were beginning to have seeds on them that I could have used, never matured so that I could keep them. Now, depending on where the plants are, sometimes they're protected and they don't freeze all the way during this first freeze. That's what's happened to this dahlia. It's been protected, It's got that mass of the waterfall behind it, and it's facing south. So we still have a couple of flowers that are, you know, they're not the best, but.
How about your monk's hood?
Monk's hood is a strong perennial. That is still going.
Now this is poisonous, right?
Every part of that is poisonous. Now some people are more susceptible. They can't even touch it. I have not had a problem with it. But this is one, again, it's like the Montauk daisy. It's one of the last flowers to bloom. The marigolds, again, the leaves have been touched. But again, this was against the wall, the sun coming up and heating the wall, and then the heat radiates off it. So we still have some flowers here. The yellow and the orange you see are tickweed again, so they're tough.
And your other dahlias over here, that was...
Well, and these are... Asters, yes. They're tough. This is their time to blossom, so we're enjoying them a lot.
And look at this. There's a tiny, tiny...
tiny little rose trying to make it. Yeah. Aw, so pretty. Now this one, we thought we had lost this rose. We've had this one for decades. It has the tiny little roses that grow in little groups. But it made it. It came back, and hopefully next year it'll be strong and more prolific like it has in the past.
Is that considered the knockout?
No. Nope.
Tea?
I always call it a tea rose. I don't know why, but like I said, the flowers are maybe only this big, but they come in a cluster.
Mm-hmm.
So they're very pretty. Another dahlia done. This was a spectacular dahlia. It looked like fireworks.
Doesn't anymore?
No. No, it doesn't. Now this is our garden that's fenced in. This is the one that we dedicated to tomatoes this year. Well, look at that sorry sight. Now I've been in there. I was trimming down the ones that were pretty much finished. Everyone that's in here now, I mean, I could pick some of these tomato berries and let them ripen, but you get so spoiled. When you taste them when they're ripe and they've ripened on the vine. Well, if you take them in the house now, yes, they'll be better than the store-bought ones, but just not the same. So what I'm gonna have to do now is take every single plant, every leaf that's on the ground, every tomato that has fallen, those will all be put into the trailer and taken to the recycling center. I want no possible insects or
Debris
of any kind, no fungus, no viruses, no bacteria that might be transferred. Tomatoes are kind of bad that way. So this will all be cleaned up. Next time you see it, it'll be clean.
And your maple?
And the maple is done.
But your Bradford pear, your peach trees are still hanging in there for a couple more weeks.
Yes, at least this one is. The main ones, this is the baby one that grew by itself, but yeah. The two main ones are, the leaves are pretty much down.
I think we may have to remove these.
Yeah, or trim them way, way back. Yeah. See what happens. But this one's going to take over, I think.
Well, we're going to have to do a lot of
trimming
on that.
Right.
You know, definitely.
But this Bradford pear will probably be going.
Now, if this tree is going to go down, though, I think it's going to be...
That way?
In the way of... Yeah, because I don't want that tree to be falling either towards the pergola
or towards
the fence.
Right.
So, and definitely not towards the house.
Really?
No. So if anywhere, I've got to get it to go in this direction. And that right now is probably a good, 30 feet tall?
Yeah, probably.
So.
It's lovely, where it is. I mean, it thinks it's wonderful, and it has been. But now that we know that the birds will come and they will take these little seeds here, these little seeds, eat them, and then drop them everywhere, and then the plant that comes up from these is not exactly like this one. and it spreads, and they're weak. So this is, I don't think it's on the invasive or the restricted or the prohibited list yet, but it probably will be at some point.
Well, it is being considered an invasive species.
Okay.
So
we're going to do our part and take down the three that we have. Strawberries, being so close to the ground, they're still green for the most part. Some of the leaves have started to gather there. I've gone in and I've pulled all the weeds that I could. And once we have the hard frost, then we'll cover them either with leaf mulch or with straw, just to keep the soil from freezing and thawing and disrupting the roots. This is our Canadian flowering cherry, and this will keep its little cherries on it all winter unless the birds eat them off. But it's a neat tree, because here you are in the middle of winter with white everywhere, and these little red berries are still up there until the birds get really hungry. Last time I think we showed you the liatris, and it kept raining and I could not harvest all of it. But now is the time where you can come out and you can just go like this, and you'll end up with a whole handful of liatris seeds. Now you may say, well, what do I do with them? Well, what I do with them is I take them and I sprinkle them all around so that they can winter and come up in the spring. And there's enough of them, so it doesn't matter if the mice or the voles or whoever eats some of them. I have plenty. So I can now go around finally and start getting all of these, and then I can chop them down because they've really looked ugly. I must admit, even I haven't liked the way they've looked. But look, if you look over there, they look like tall, I don't know what. They're not pretty.
Well, you definitely are going to get a lot of seeds from these.
Yep, definitely are.
And this was one of our natives that they talked about, remember?
Yes.
Yeah.
Liatris are native, and the bees love them, especially the bumblebees really like them. And I've seen hummingbirds on them also.
Well, butterflies too. I've seen many butterflies.
Love them, yeah. Yes. So, you know, if you've watched any of my videos, I love them. And I will put them everywhere. And, you know, people will walk by or drive over and say, you know, what do you have? And I say, here, do you want some liatris? You have two kinds of hibiscus. You have the tropical hibiscus and you have the hardy hibiscus. Hardy hibiscus will make it through our Wisconsin winter. Not the leaves, no. All the leaves will fall off. All of the little shoots will stay up. And I'll trim them if I have time later on. Maybe I'll trim them down to about this high. But I want them to stay there so that the leaves and the snow can collect again to protect the roots from freezing and thawing. Because on a really cold, frosty day, the sun comes out and the soil right around the base will start thawing out. And then, of course, nighttime comes and they'll freeze again. And if they're not protected by leaves or by snow, it's just a matter of freezing and thawing and freezing and thawing, and it weakens them. So this was the dark red one. This was the white one. This was a pink one. And next year, hopefully, if everything goes right, they'll be even bigger than this.
Well, these don't seem to be as touched as badly, but again, they're on the south side.
Yes.
They're protected by the house.
So. Right. So the heat from the house will radiate out and keep them a little bit longer than something that's out in the open.
So that's why you open the office window.
Yes.
You want to heat up the plants outside, right?
No, I can't even open my screens now on a nice day like this because we have what's known as the brown reticulated stink bug. And later in the afternoon when it gets warmer, those darn stink bugs come out and they try to get in between your window and your screen so that you can keep them warm all winter. And then suddenly they'll somehow get out of that and they will be crawling around or flying around in your living room or in your bedroom. So for the last couple of weeks, I cannot even open a window because I don't want them sneaking in.
And we have some really good windows too.
Yes, we
so
do.
That was surprising.
Yep, I don't know how they do it.
I think you bring them in.
No, I don't.
They're your favorite pet.
No, they're not. Because it's going to be freezing, if you have bird baths that have water in them or garden artwork that catches water, granted you should be dumping those the ornamental parts out or cleaning out your bird bath every couple of days because of the mosquitoes, but now it's because they're going to start freezing. And you know what happens when glass freezes. If it's got water in it, it'll crack. So if you enjoy your tender garden art, dump it out, tip it over. This is flax. It's not been bothered by it. Here's another garden art that needs to be tipped over. Otherwise it's gonna freeze and crack. This is your lamb's ear. You can see that's hasn't been touched. Oftentimes lamb's ear, if you see it under the snow, if you dig down and see it, it's still green. So that one sometimes doesn't even turn. Our compass plant is done now. It says, nope, winter's here. Even though it's native to Wisconsin and it's a prairie plant, it does have its cycle of, that's it, I'm done. Again, if you're looking for something that continues to bloom even way into the fall, your Montauk daisy, which is part of the chrysanthemum family, is one that'll do that. I mean, you couldn't even tell that this has had frost. Now, some of these buds look like maybe they were touched a little bit, but the ones that were already open, no. If you also want color, the red twig dogwood is the twigs stay red all winter, so that's kind of a neat thing. And then if you look out toward the road, you see that the marigolds, while the leaves have been touched, the flower still is blessing us with the yellow color. Those will all be pulled out. These I will just put along the edges out of the way, but the nematodes that these draw into the soil, they attract the good ones, the good nematodes that you like. So if you can, keep them, crunch them up if you can, or roll over them with the lawnmower and then sprinkle them in among your plants. You'll be encouraging good things in your soil. Again, this is our monk's hood. This is how tall it can get. If you want a beautiful purple color in your garden, I saw yesterday there were bumblebees on here. Again, they are poison. So if you have young children.
Or dogs.
Well, I don't know that dogs
even bother
them. Yeah, but you know, it is a poison plant, but if you're not eating it, it's fine and it's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. How about your cannas?
The cannas? Well, they got a chance to actually, a couple of them bloomed a little bit. Those are tender bulbs. Again, those will have to be dug up and cured for a few weeks in the cool dryness and then trimmed off and then stored in an open bin in the basement. If we had a root cellar, that'd be even better because that'd be cooler. But nowadays, people's basements don't get as cool as they used to, so we just have to do the best we can. If you had a heated garage, that would be great too. Any place that does not freeze is good. Another plant that is still pretty is the Russian sage. Again, the pretty green with the white stems.
You may silver.
You may still have some blossoms on it. This would be a good time if you want to harvest some and make a potpourri or a pretty smelling bouquet in your house. It smells very nice.
And the little pink flowers.
And these are guara, I think they're, that we were told.
Delicate.
Very delicate, very wispy. This is the first time we've had it, so we didn't know it was going to get that tall. And maybe next time, before it gets too big, I'll put one of those little rings around it so it can be seen better.
Well, there was no label on it when we bought it, so it just we saw the interesting flower in the stem, and we thought, well, let's give it a try and see what happens.
Yeah, and we like it. Yeah. The sweet alyssum still blossoming. That doesn't seem to have been bothered at all. Now, hopefully the sweet alyssum will seed itself and perhaps not come back as full as these are, because I planted these, but some of them should still pop up underneath the soil. As you can see, the Frosty garden has its ups and its downs. Unfortunately for the elephant ears, it's down. But cycle of life, everything needs to take a rest. And it's been a beautiful summer. We've loved the flowers. We've loved the greenery and the burgundies and all the different colors that came about. And so now we're gonna give them a chance to rest up and get ready for next year.
Can I rest up and get ready for next year too?
Yes, you may. And remember, when you're working in your yard, you see a lot of things that need to be done. Don't be guilty if you don't get them all done. They'll be waiting for you next spring, just where you left them. Bye for now. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, give us a thumbs up, please. And if you have comments or questions, please leave them. Also, if you'd like to join in our garden conversation, join our garden family and hit the little subscribe button right over here. Thanks for watching. Stay warm.
Connect with us on YouTube.